it was the first summer show I did, and they gave me a really nice spot, and so it was, you used it as a sort of springboard for a piece that was already happening. You don't know where you're going to go or what you're going to put next, do you? And you have no control about how the piece was shown. I've had work that was on a plinth and I wanted it to be shown at a certain height, and the plinth was halved in height because of some other concerns within the room. So as successful artists, we're all used to having control and that privilege of being able to control one's environment and showing in exact conditions. And the summer show is kind of the opposite of that. I kind of jokingly call it the curatorial antichrist, because no matter what you try and do to try and create some rules and some constraints, they get diminished and destroyed by just what it is, this heaving kind of democratic amalgam that it is. If you want to be controlling and try and project some kind of regime, it's pretty upsetting because you can't. It is what it is, and there's no, so you just have to kind of relax and just try and let go with it, because it's just, I don't know, otherwise you get pretty upset. I wasn't that involved. The curators that year just placed it there, but it was nice because it was my first summer show as an RA. They were quite keen to sort of give me a nice spot. It can be pretty random where you end up, and I was lucky that year. Some years you're luckier than others. It was really nice to be able to pop in and show it to people. So I must have gone half a dozen times. I guess sort of every time you approached it, you sort of digest something, whether consciously or subconsciously, and you get a sense of its scale. I think one of the things about the piece is it feels, at first you think it doesn't have a front or a back, but it became quite clear that there is a front and a back, where the crest of the work, the apex of the piece, has to come to the front. Prototyping is essential. I don't think I've ever made a prototype that didn't change before you actually made it, because you always learn so much. And even renders on a screen, you can't really get a sense of the scale of something. So it's really important to create, ideally, sort of one-to-one models of things, but that can't always be the case for scale studies of a piece. That was the first time it was shown. I did a show at Victoria Miro, I think the next year, in which I had a whole array of iterations of these vertical forms, which included these sort of ascending stacks of tetroids, which are the paradigms, and then these descending works, which are these ones where time is moving downwards, and you have this, which are called manifolds, which are these kind of harmonic works. So you have these ascending works and descending works all in a room. So it was a sort of quite a formal arrangement of all these studies. They are quite architecture in a way, in that so we have lots of constraints in which we put upon them. There is this fundamental geometry, which is based on the tetrahelix, which is a way that you put tetrahedrons together and they form this kind of never-ending triple helix that sort of goes on forever, but in a straight line, but never actually comes back full circle. I made a sculpture in 2008 or 2007. It's called Axiom, which is in the Ministry of Justice in Petit France, in St. James's. It's meant to be a public sculpture, but actually because of security issues, it's in this atrium of the, it's a government office, and only the people who work there can see it. But it's essentially a stack of regular tetrahedrons that rise up, but because of perspective, it actually looks like it sort of gets smaller as you go up, but in fact it's actually the same. So I think one of the things that led on to a few years later was this idea of escalation and this idea of growth or expansion, and there is this sense of cumulative sort of time is moving upwards, and there is this sort of growth or entropy or surging force. One of the key factors in public realm work is things like climbability and things like this. Technically, I would never have been allowed to make a hollow one. So the solidity is really key to the climbability issue. So they do differ in that sense. There is this precariousness to it, which is really, I think, is the sort of excitement about it. And the piece is genuinely working really hard. The one in St. Pancras is very, very heavily engineered, and the materials are working really hard. And if you were to add another tetrahedron, it would collapse under its own weight. So it's kind of quite perilous in some ways. But what I like about it is that there's this sort of, hopefully, a kind of sense of the apocalypse with it, that inevitably this thing will collapse. Any form of growth will lead to collapse. It's got such a small footprint. When we were looking at the plans, there's all the sort of Thames Link and all the railway lines and the services underneath. It's completely congested. And actually, the exact spot I chose for it that fitted the concave kind of dogleg in the facade turned out to be the only place that was able to take the sculpture. So there was a real kind of destiny. That was a really nice sign because it was literally exactly where I wanted it. And it was the only choice because it could have had to be forced to be 10 metres to the left or 5 metres back or somewhere just random. But it was actually a real bit of fortuitous luck. Their responses to spaces and to context and to subject matter and to people who use the demographics of people who use it. So I like trying to solve problems with the works. The ideas come from the problems that a specific location or a site will throw up. And so the pieces are dependent upon those problems. And so they're ideas driven from being given a set of constraints.